I want to take you back in time to 1972. Some of you remember this, and some of you might remember this visiting NASA this past March. But this was the last time humans were on their way to the moon. And on their way to the moon, at a distance of 29,000 kilometers, 18,000 miles, the astronaut crew of Apollo 17 looked back at planet Earth and captured this. Now, I lost the dramatic effect because it's not working. So, let's try again. They captured this. Oh, thank you. The blue marble, one of the most reproduced images in history. And there are three reasons why I'm starting off with this iconic image. The first, I get to start off with history, which people don't realize that that's a field that is researched within space sciences as well. And by doing so, I get easy credits from our rector, Professor Chaim Hames. The second, everyone is familiar with the term and with the saying, a picture is worth a thousand words. Well, Hadass and Jeff only gave me 10 minutes to speak, and I have to squeeze in all of BGU's space program and my own research, and explaining about Earth observations and satellite technology could be challenging, but for me, this image summarizes it all very well, because it captures our environment. It demonstrates through the dark void how challenging space could be. And it also shows the current technology that could be used. Most people would look at this image and only see the dark void and the challenges. But for me, this image holds the opportunity. And that opportunity is also my last reason. This is a glance also to the future. Humanity is going back to the moon, on their way to Mars. So we at BGU are going back to the moon on our way to Mars. How are we going to do this? Allow me to introduce myself and explain. My name is Dr. Shimrit Maman. I'm a senior scientist at the Homeland Security Institute, and I head the Israeli United Nations Regional Support Office that deals with everything related to disaster management from space. Fascinated with space when I grew up, I did not have a dream that one day I will launch a satellite. But through my BGU journey, I was provided with this out-of-this-world opportunity. BGU has one of the most unique space programs. Living and working in this desert region makes space seem like an extension of our research playground. And it is evident from our collaborators, as NASA, United Nations, the German Space Agency, JAXA, and many, many more, that they have learned how innovative and creative we are. And I just want to zoom in to the Israeli space program. It is remarkable to think about it that the first peace agreement with an Arab country actually ignited our national space program. 1979, the Israel-Egypt peace treaty posed a new challenge for the IDF. We were not able to fly over Egypt as we used to. And the creative solution was, if you can't fly, float. From the early start, BGU had an involvement with the Israeli space program, and I would like to shout out to Professor Danny Blumberg. Which is not only my boss, but also is now the chairperson of the Israeli Space Agency. Our very own. And on this slide, there are two exciting involvements that BGU has since its early start, but I'm just going to refer to two. First, 2017 BGU SAT and 2017 Venus satellite. And I'm going to start with Venus, not because it was launched later that year, but it's just because the building next door is the building where the ground satellite receiving station of Venus is situated. And on that mission, we have the chief scientist, Professor Arnon Carnielli, here from the Midrasha. And don't be confused with Venus the planet. This is a new satellite that is vegetation and environment monitoring on a new microsatellite, very innovative in both the science and technology. Starting off with that, I'm just gonna move on to my nanosatellite because I had one. For the past 60 years, satellites have been orbiting Earth and imaging not just Earth, but also other planets. And the thing that is changing is the reduction in size. And we're talking about a nanosatellite, and most people don't realize its size, so I brought the model. And this is the size. Now, this started off as a new standard back in the 90s, where universities were introduced to the ability to enable their students with affordable hands-on space education. And this is a 10 by 10 by 30 centimeters. It's a 3-unit, okay, a 3U CubeSat. But the standard is 10 by 10 by 10, just 1U. Most universities will encourage you to think out of the box. But here at BGU, sometimes we realize that there is a limitation also in size, and that makes your science be within that box. So, what's so innovative about this satellite? First of all, we showed a technology demonstration. We were able to reduce the size of a large satellite as big as a bus and do a better job. The second one, we actually get to have our students experience hands-on space education, not just by talking theory, by actually doing. And where is Professor Chaimovic? Well, he's, yeah, okay, I'm sorry. Well, he wants us to do that thing which all universities are supposed to do. And of course, we have a lot of science going on with it. Over 30 research groups were on the satellite. And this was a historic launch. As you could see, the PSLV rocket that it was launched upon, with 103 other satellites, all operative. But our satellite was the only one in the universe to have a shortwave infrared camera on it. So we are very proud of that as well. And, And at a speed of 7.5 kilometers per second, we did a lot. We achieved a lot of Earth observations, and we demonstrated the technology, and we also had an attitude control system on it that controlled the direction of the satellite, which is something very innovative in such a small CubeSat. But sadly, all good things come to an end, and after being so proud in Texas, that my satellite is operative for over 6 years. A week later, it returned its soul to the god of satellites and re-entered the atmosphere. Now, if you would have asked me 10 years ago if my research will serve as an heritage for a lunar mission, I would probably answer no. Because when you're making history, you don't realize it. You're just doing your job. And going back to the moon, the computer on BGUSAT served as space heritage for the Bereshit lunar mission. And going to the future aspects of the moon, we have now our own teams developing the next sensors for future Mars and Moon missions in the form of hyperspectral compressive sensing cameras, which I know means Chinese to you, but that's really good stuff, okay? And that's Professor Adrian Stern's team. BGU science was recognized also by United Nations. And working with the UN is a challenge, not because, this may be shocking to some of you, but not everybody likes us. But we managed to establish the first and only regional support office in Ben-Gurion University, the only Israeli regional support office. And this is an entity by UN that is called SPIDER. And I always make the joke that I'm a spider woman, but apart with dealing with disaster management and emergency response from space, which could be quite depressing, I could tell you that there's nothing more rewarding than seeing our science put into good use and action. And this is not just a science achievement. This is also a very great achievement for the state of Israel. Sometimes all you have to do is just send the right woman for the job. And speaking of women, this week you got to see incredible researchers from Ben-Gurion University. And working on the satellite and being always the only female scientist in the room and having my daughter, Yuval, ask me, "Mommy, why don't you have any astronaut female friends?" And I said, "Okay, we have to make this a better world for everybody." And by doing, and I was very fortunate to have all the support from everybody and establish She Space. And She Space is a program that motivates girls to try and use STEAM education. And I just get to do it by allowing them to enter the lab, by coming in to the Earth and Planetary Image Facility and working with us. But this went way above my dreams and expectations when this last February, we had our own She Space participant, Noah Rocker, present in the UN on behalf of BGU and on behalf of the State of Israel. I'm on a time here, so stop clapping. And a very exciting moment for us on their way to the UN, to the UN in Vienna. Everything related to space is situated in Vienna. We were there, and in the airport, we saw all the emergency forces going on their way to Turkey to save lives. Little did they know at the time who I am and what I was doing for them. Danny was with me the whole time. But we were trying to get as many Israeli satellites to take images of Turkey and Syria in order to support from space all the forces on the ground. And we were able to do that. And I am very, very proud to show you one of the images, even though depressing, but from an Israeli satellite provided to the UN and to everybody that could save lives. But everything I talked about now is not rocket science. Actually, we did not have rocket science at Ben-Gurion University till this year, when I was approached by students, our very own Space Gurion community. And this is... and this is where our BGU spirit kicks in. Because while Spirit and Opportunity are rovers that went to Mars, I'm taking that analogy and showing you the whole path of how, given an opportunity, you get the BGU spirit. So, thank you, Space Gurion, and looking at the future and understanding what people do for us space-wise just by enabling us the opportunity, I would like to refer to our next speaker, which provided us with this amazing opportunity and did no other than allow us to experiment on his brain. Eytan Stibbe is not only the second Israeli astronaut, he is a very, very dear friend. And I would like to call you to provide your talk now. Thank you, Eytan.
Thank you, Shimrit, and she was a big part of my the success of my mission together with Dani. They were part of the committees that selected and chose what I would do in space. And I did dream about going to space. And when frequently asked by kids, okay, you went to space, you fulfilled your dream, what's your next? So, except for learning Arabic, I told them to go to the moon. And here I am in Sde Bokir, which is closest to the moon. You know, it looks like the moon. So thank you for inviting me here. So we signed up just when the SpaceX started sending people to space again from the US, I signed up. And then I started learning what that means, what the meaning of, okay, going to space, 10 days, what am I going to do there? And that was a challenge. So we, with the Ramon Foundation, and with the experienced Israeli Space Agency, we set out to start thinking of what we can do in space. Okay, so this is obviously one of the relevant actual issues in Israel. This is a prayer for the safety of Israel that the president of Israel gave me, and we had to go through hell to get to persuade NASA to approve taking a glass cube because it can break. So the thing was that it is completely different. Okay, I'm going to space, there's no space agency supporting me. What am I going to do? Who's going to decide what I do? So we started defining the main themes of the mission, which was, first of all, everyone should be part of this. Everyone, meaning kindergarten to Nobel Prize winners, through everyone, not only scientists and not only STEM enthusiasts and space freaks, and not only those, but everyone, poets, philosophers, children, everyone. So that was the first mission. The second was to collaborate with the public sector, which means the Ministry of Education, Ministry of Science, and so forth. And the third was, the solution for that was to, because we had a very short schedule, the solution was to open the mission up. So it's an open source, call for proposals, and we got thousands of ideas from crazy things I won't share with you, but from things that we did, for example, a poetry competition for high schools. So kids, we chose the subject perspective, and kids sent poems, and a team of literature experts chose the two poems that I would read in Hebrew from space. So that's the extreme artist participates. I'll show you some later. So at the end, we had many entities join us and build the mission. To send stuff to space, except for a human, which is complex, needs some training, is very challenging. So Ben-Gurion suggested I take a EEG helmet, size of a helmet, big helmet. It's very complex to go through all the procedures and get the authorization, packaging, and all the risks and dangers. So at the end, with 140 missions to do in space, the idea, the biggest challenge was to integrate my work into the work of 11 other or 10 other astronauts that were with me on the station. That's another challenge, because there's only one glove box, and there's only one cupola window, and there's a limit of what you can do. So to match all these things and bring them together was a huge challenge in itself, and we brought one of the ladies, young lady, to sit in Houston, in Huntsville, and coordinate all this implementation of this Israeli crazy program. Because IMPA-3, private astronaut number 3, you see, and the schedules are built to 15, every 15 minutes you know what you do. This is a 15-minute slot. And you can't move anything. I mean, if you miss something, you go to the toilet, you're thirsty or something, it's gone. You have to inform that you didn't do it, and then they'll try to find another slot in the following day to do the work. So here's the training. This is my daughter. She was my backup. She's a physician, and everyone wanted her to fly. She looks better. She's smarter. She's everything. But it was my dream, so let her complete her dreams. This is the Building 9 of JSC in Houston, the training center, which is the full station, full-size station, but relatively clean. So you can see what astronaut training means. It's basically two main things. One is the Uber, like SpaceX, taking you back and forth, which is a spaceship and it has its own everything, food, sleep, toilet, operations, safety, and the space station, which is a completely different thing that has modules, the Russian modules, the American, Japanese, and European. So we moved around all these places to learn about each model so we can use the labs and the equipment there. On the station, there are two toilets, and both are Russian, by the way. So when one broke, we went to use the Russian, the toilet on the Russian side, but it's exactly the same. So this is, for example, how you CPR, right? And you need to push against something. So these are common medical issues for those who care, but it's a challenge. It's a physical challenge, and we were by far the oldest crew that flew to space ever. Even when there were 7 on a shuttle, the collective age was younger than the 4 of us, because we had 172 and a few younger guys. This is the Houston Human Space Flight Mission Control Center. So we created a similar center here in Tel Aviv, because there was a huge curiosity in all sectors to see how it works, and we succeeded to get all the live stream of information, videos, and everything from NASA, from SpaceX, to the Tel Aviv Center. So scientists could sit in the center, talk to me live, and we could share, and in the background there was an exhibition of many issues related to the mission. So here, just a small feeling, this is the missile that crashed 2 weeks ago, you remember? SpaceX, the huge one, and that's the thrust it has, and this is the SLS that went to the moon and returned successfully. And we chose a smaller model, the Falcon 9, which is what could take us to the space station. It's the only one today. So about a year ago, there were 2 wonders of mankind, technological wonders, standing here in Cape Canaveral, the Falcon 9 and the SLS, ready to go to the moon. And it was delayed and delayed and delayed. Eventually it flew a few months ago. It was planned to go before us. But a few hours before this, we came from the quarantine, the 4 of us. The helicopter from Orlando, super excited. So our physician and the 4 of us.
Morning, sir.
So this small bag is the stuff we want when we come back, when we land. We get in our suits, get in the Teslas, put on this song in full volume in the car.
One shot, one opportunity.
Full volume, because you're with the helmet, with the earplugs and everything.
One moment, but you capture just let it slip. Yo. His palms are sweaty, knees weak, arms are heavy. There's vomit on his sweater already. Mom's spaghetti, he's nervous, but on the surface he looks calm and ready to drop bombs.
Perfect song, isn't it?
He keeps on forgetting what he wrote down. The whole crowd goes so loud. He opens his mouth, but the words won't come out. Lose yourself in the music. The moment you own it, you better never let it go.
So Mark and I in the Tesla.
Miss your chance to blow. This opportunity comes once in a lifetime. You better.
Was a super exciting, and you every minute you don't believe it's going to happen, and you progress and progress and eventually get in the elevator. And launch. Right here. Here we leave Earth. It's the first time we leave Earth, and this is the launch pad 39A where all the Apollo mission was launched and all the shuttle missions were launched from. So it's really a nice thing. We cross, walk across the arm and sign the wall. I sign in Hebrew, as you see, and I ask them even to put Hebrew on my shoulder. And we were four private astronauts, myself, Mark from Canada, Larry from Dayton, Ohio, and Mark, and Mike. MLA is a super astronaut. He has the, he's a Hall of Fame astronaut of NASA. He has the record of spacewalks in the world. So he's a guy to hold your hand when you go there. Right? And Nelson, the head of NASA, he called him caretaker. You're experienced, you're taking three rookies. So we bought him a set of pacifiers to hand us so he could, you know, relax us on the launch. Probably you know that, about 45 minutes before launch, everyone gets as far as possible from the from this dangerous location, and then they start fueling it. Only then. And then we Earth, wait for the...
Six. Go for launch.
For that very...
SpaceX Endeavour, we acknowledge. Go for launch.
Go for launch is...
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3,
2, so we shout...
One, and zero. Count. Ignition. Stop. Go Falcon, go Dragon. Godspeed, Axiom 1.
There we go. And it's super smooth. It looks like shaking in movies and rumbling, but it's not. It's smooth. It's wonderful. It's a wonderful feeling. One of the things I did before launch was read a song of Konstantin Kavafi, which is Ithaca. Means that the way is important, not the achieving the actual goal. So 3 minutes and we're out there in space. And our super astronaut tells us, welcome, you're now your astronauts. Okay, we can V and come back, right? So this is a video taken by one of the astronauts on the station of us approaching. So we approach from the bottom and then turn over and come from the top to dock. It's a bit fast forward, but it looks like science fiction, but it's real. And then we dock. The pressures are equalized, and I go to this small window in the hatch, and I see people on the other side, which is incredible. You know it's coming, and you know who's, you met them on the ground, but you actually see them. And that's a super exciting moment. Then we start seeing these incredible images. What you don't see from so far away is the atmosphere. And here you can see the atmosphere, this small, like, bluish line around Earth, which the feeling is when you look at it, that you just, you know, you just blow at it and it goes away. And we know that without that atmosphere, we would look like Mars. So this is Israel and the... Cyprus, Egypt, the Nile. Dead Sea. Dead Sea is a super important location on Earth. It's the lowest place on Earth, and there's a research center in the Dead Sea where even NASA learn about extreme life in extreme environments. So this is about over Tehran. This is how we look from there, and you see something unique. It's a tower, yeah, the Ashalim Tower. Yeah, no Photoshop. You just see that there. And the second arrow is here, is the place we're sitting now. So this is how it looks. It's really amazing. And here's the atmosphere at night, over, I don't know where. But it's beautiful. You can see the formation, the big bear, star formation on the top. But the colors are incredible, especially at night. And people usually don't go to watch Earth at night. And I was taking videos of thunderstorms, which were all done at night. So I was lucky to see these amazing, amazing images, the solar panel there. And all this, you see the stars through the atmosphere, but this is 100 kilometer. So that's all. And below us, 100 kilometer, we have Laba at 1,000 Celsius, over 1,000 Celsius. So our life can really be just in this small, 10 down, 10 up, and that's it. Gives you proportion. So the temperatures in space are plus minus more than 100 degrees. This is the return.
The external temperatures of Dragon reach about 3,500 degrees Fahrenheit.
Couldn't avoid thinking of the Columbia 20 years ago, 19 years ago, when going through atmosphere at these huge temperatures.
Dragon, SpaceX, comm check.
7 minutes of loss of signal. We were happy in the cockpit, but the families were a bit excited.
Copy that. Great to hear from you.
Gravity is heavy, I must tell you. After 17 days in space, you can't lift the remote.
On behalf of the entire SpaceX team, welcome back to planet Earth. We hope you enjoyed the extra few days in space, and thanks for choosing to follow SpaceX.
So I asked for frequent flyer points, you know. So this was a 17-day mission. For those who don't remember, the whole space program started not so long ago, human spaceflight program. And the competition led to the Americans stepping on the moon first, but then the rest of the exploration must be done jointly. So the international cooperation created this International Space Station, and I believe that the moon and Mars will be done in cooperation. There's no other way. And recently, just in 2020, 21, the private sector entered big time into the space sector, and that will make the change, because the justification of SpaceX is that they reduced the cost of sending cargo to the International Space Station, for example, by a third, to a third of its original cost, and so forth. So it's a great achievement, and there were very few people to go to space to come and tell these stories. So what I just told before in the break, that we have to send more poets, artists to space so they can better explain the experience to all of us. So this is the International Space Station. The living and pressurized quarters are only this central side. All the rest you need to use spacewalks. NASA charges $130,000 per astronaut hour. We go around Earth 16 times a day. That means 16 sunsets and 16 sunrises, which is very romantic. If you're sad, you go there, you can cry quietly in the window. So it's 7 minutes from London. And this is how it looks inside. Each rack is a laboratory or more. There's no up and down. And here we can see some of the stuff I did. This is a training on the EEG helmet that Ben-Gurion sent with me. It was a big, big mission. It was a big package. There's no room in the spacecraft. And they checked my brain. And I asked two other astronauts to join this experiment and check their brain. And I don't know why, but 1 year after, they didn't show us the results yet. So I'm a bit worried about that. But it was really an amazing experiment, very complex, in the middle of the US laboratory. We did what I told you is looking for the electric effects of thunderstorms from the cloud to the top of the atmosphere. So TLEs, sprites and elves and so forth. So only when you go frame by frame you can find the special effects. And what is interesting is that 2 days ago we guided or instructed the next AX2 team that are going to continue this experiment in space next week. And on AX2 there are 2 Americans and 2 Saudis. Here I do the, here you can see that I'm working on the station and the scientists in Tel Aviv can follow everything I'm doing and shout at me if they need to, if I'm doing something wrong. And this is a CRISPR experiment, biology, cutting DNA. I never knew what I signed in for here because it was 2 sessions of 3.5 hours pipetting. It's not much fun. And you have the scientists in the ear, and it's continuous, 3.5 hours. Another experiment was creating lenses in space from liquids. The idea is that you can create for education, for example, we demonstrated that we could create a telescope out of water, lenses out of liquid, and you can change the size of them and everything. And here we created, with a polymer, we created lenses and hardened them to see how they harden. And you can see I'm working here in a glove box, creating lenses. This was a cooperation with NASA because it's the first time it was ever done. So there's no frame, there's only a ring, there's no frame. We created perfect lenses just with the face tension. And then this is an artwork. If anyone knows Marina Abramovich, it would sit in a museum and do nothing. So I was asked by Ohad Pishov to do the same. It's called Nothing in Space. So in order to, and it's very interesting because he asked me to 1 hour, but I could do only half an hour. I put some cables to hold me in one place, and I sat there for, I floated there for 30 minutes, and it's an experience. At the first moment you think of, okay, it's how much time passed, 1 minute, 5 minutes, how much is left, but then you know, the people are working around you and you just float into a wonderful experience. If you remember this guy. What I could say about this is that the thing that was most missing, that I was longing for in space, was fresh fruit, smell of the sea, you know, wind, all those don't exist there. It's very technical. I took experiments of students, and a lady prepared lessons, video lessons that are all in Hebrew and YouTube. Today are over 40 lessons in physics, geography, science. This, for example, is an experiment where I show the face tension of a liquid. This is a water bubble, and I push a ping pong ball into it. It looks like an egg. So I had this personal preference kit, and I took some stuff, obviously my grandkids' stuff, and a painting that Noor Ramon, the daughter of Ilan, painted. She painted his diary falling back from space to Earth because it was found in Texas, and I celebrated Pesach there. I invited Eliyahu, he didn't come. And I took my favorite painting and a small pin, allowed it to float in space. And I took a broken shell, which I didn't know the why, but it came out to be a very beautiful video of from the. So just a feeling, a few numbers. Our success was based on this, right, Shimrit? But we really had a very wide participation in the mission from the whole country, and we checked our results and performance according to the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, and we our main contributions were to good health and quality education, industry, and climate action. So, this is David Ben-Gurion who said in Israel, in order to be a realist, you must believe in miracles, which I agree with sitting here in the Negev. Thank you very much.
Eytan, I was going over my Outlook, and I found an email from 10th of April, 2022. And it says, Eytan, hi, this is Jeff. I'm asking you on behalf of Danny if you can come on Wednesday because your family have now achieved Ben-Gurion Society status in the university as donors to the African studies. And could you come and be at the wall on Wednesday? And you, an hour later, you said, sorry, Jeff, I'm really busy, can't make it Wednesday. It's really important to Danny. Are you sure? Can you not make it Wednesday? Can you not change your plans? Sorry, tell Danny I'm really... Where are you? I'm in space. So, we couldn't do it then, but we can do it today, please.
Our thank
acceptance,
you. Thank you
the Ben-Gurion Society. Thank you very much for everything you do to BGU.